is on the YouTube chat, and any questions you have, we'll try and answer at the end. So if you put your questions in the chat, we'll be able to answer them there, okay? Also to let you know that we will be recording this, so look out on our YouTube page for the when it goes up on live on our YouTube page in a week or so, and we'll also send you the deck at the end as well, so don't worry about if you miss anything. So before we start, we'll go into a platform introduction from Katie, who works with Twitter, and she'll talk you through how the platform works, and this is the basic intro for the platform itself. I'll then come back online and talk to you about platform features and how to use them, how to build an audience, how to measure results. Then I'll jump on with Katie and we'll talk about new features and insights from Twitter during the lockdown. And then we'll wrap it up, okay? So without further ado, I'm gonna stop sharing and hand over to Katie.
Hi everyone, my name is Katie. I manage Twitter's work with charities in the UK. Thank you for having me here today. It's great to have the opportunity to talk with you all. And hopefully this is the first conversation of others that I'm sure will follow. So I'm not going to talk for too long, probably about 15 minutes. And I'm just going to give an overview of what Twitter is, how it differs to other social media services, and some of the different ways that you might want to consider using Twitter. So I'm going to start with a question. What is Twitter? And the way we define it is Twitter is what's happening. What do we mean by that? First of all, the volume of conversation. We see about 500 million tweets every day about all sorts of different subjects. We have just under 200 million users who come onto Twitter every day. But I think a more interesting statistic is that we see over 1 billion unique visits from embedded tweets. So that means you might see a tweet embedded in a news website or on another social media platform. And I think that speaks to another opportunity of Twitter to be syndicated in other places as well. What surprised me when I started working for Twitter is just how much use is outside the US for an American company, that the vast majority of our users now are outside the US. And interestingly, about 2 in 5 are listeners. And I think that's really important when thinking about how you're using Twitter. Sometimes you might put something out and it doesn't get much engagement in terms of replies or likes or retweets. But it's really important to remember that there's a large number of users on Twitter who are logging on every day. They're really interested. They just may not be physically engaging with your tweets. So that's always important to bear in mind if you've put something out and it doesn't seem like it's got the response that you thought it would. If there's one thing to take away from me during this session today, it's this, and it's how Twitter explodes during cultural moments. We've done research that shows that people go off other social media services and onto Twitter for these major public moments, things like the World Cup or Eurovision or the Oscars, but even more regular moments. So things like when Great British Bake Off is on, you see people come onto Twitter because they want to participate in or read what the public discussion is about these events that people are watching or thinking about. And that's really important when considering your social media strategy. It presents opportunities to connect yourself to wider conversations and build your audience out in new places. So how is it different to other social media services? What you might find with others are that they're more private spaces. They're an opportunity to share personal information, personal updates, family photos, holiday photos, a bit more look at me. Twitter we see as more look at this. People log on expecting news, information, sport. And what you'll typically see on Twitter is people sharing their perspective on very public issues or public topics. So while Hayden's going to go through more of a training and go into more detail, I'm just going to take some time to share some of the ways that you might consider using Twitter and some of the good tweets that I have seen and that might be of interest to you and some inspiration. So how can Twitter be used? I think first and foremost, it's a tool to educate people. People come onto Twitter with a real discovery mindset. They expect new information. They're looking to get insight into new areas of interest. And there's plenty of ways to educate beyond just your followers, but to connect with people who may have a passing interest as well. So there's a few examples on screen. If we just start with the one on the left, which is from today, it's an Arts Council England thread, and it's just educating people on the ways that museums are now have reopened their doors in light of COVID and the lockdown. And it's just going through one by one the different opportunities to engage with those museums. Moving on to the Hayward Gallery, this is one I really like, which is giving some insight into an exhibition they have. And it's giving a snippet, a snapshot of one of the photographs that's being featured. And it's drawing people in with the opportunity to learn more about Among the Trees and consider going to the exhibition. And there's one on the right there, again, Arts Council. The reason I picked it out is it just contains a really nice, snappy statistic about the music industry and the jobs it supports and the financial value that it brings. And I do find myself on Twitter, when I'm looking at retweets, when I'm looking at tweets that do well, they often do contain those nice little nuggets of data or statistics. And I think that is a real opportunity to educate people who want to see those insights. Twitter is also a place to have great conversations. I've got an example here from NASA, and if you don't follow them on Twitter already, definitely recommend, even just as inspiration for your own Twitter strategy, because they're great. But there's just a couple of things I wanted to point out here. On the left, you can see they're having a conversation with Twitter. Twitter put out good news and bad news, 2020 is half over. And NASA replied, but look, spacewalk, advertising that they're live streaming a spacewalk. And on the right, you can see a couple of astronauts having a conversation about NASA's work getting to Mars. So why is this important? I think it's a couple of things. First, it's the opportunity to create really compelling content. You may find this from your own Twitter use, but invariably people will be more interested to see a conversation about an issue rather than just one person broadcasting it out. And you can really see that at play here on the right. And then the other important thing about having these conversations is that it's an opportunity to build a connection, perhaps with an organization working in a similar space to you, or with some other type of organization that's nearby, and just communicate to their followers as well that you're here and you have something relevant to say that may be of interest to them. Something I see all the time on Twitter is calls to action. And I think that's one of the things Twitter is most famous for, particularly in comparison to other social media services, how much people use it to organize and use it for activism. You can see a classic example of that on the right, where it's a call for people to sign a petition. And you can see something a bit different on the left, which is just, you know, if you're age 15 to 25, interested in learning bookbinding, sign up here. And the reason I'm sharing this slide is just to say, don't be hesitant, be confident. If someone has taken the time to follow your account, they're really interested in knowing what's going on and being involved and playing an active role in the work you're doing. So never be afraid to share a call to action, whatever it may be. Chances are it's what your followers expect, and you'll probably be surprised, pleasantly surprised, to see how much they want to retweet it and make it available to their followers as well. This is really focused on polls, but the broader message is the opportunity on Twitter to ask your audience questions. And on the one hand, it's a good opportunity to just be a bit more engaged with your followers. So rather than just broadcasting tweets, it's the opportunity to have more of a conversation by asking a question. Polls specifically, which are featured here, is also a really helpful way to just test out an idea or quite quickly get a perspective from your followers. Sometimes it can be kind of funny. So you can see Richard Osman in the bottom right. He uses Twitter polls all the time, sometimes just as a bit of a joke, which you can see here to start a kind of funny conversation. But sometimes people use them for really important questions. The example in the middle is just from this week. Who was best at the Democratic National Convention? And you can see about 15,000 replies, largely focused on AOC believed to have performed best at the Democratic National Convention. So Twitter provides a really good opportunity just to test out, even if it's an aspect of your strategy you want to get a view on, or you're thinking about planning for 2021, or just to have a conversation. And if you want to take that a step further, something I really enjoy seeing on Twitter is a Q&A. And this is one I did last year. And hosting a Twitter Q&A is really straightforward. It's basically finding someone or a group of people who are happy to answer questions on Twitter at a specific period of time. So you could do a high-tech version of that and live stream a conversation and invite people to tweet at the time and answer questions in the moment. Or you can do something just a bit more simple and straightforward, which is saying, next Wednesday between 2 and 3 o'clock, I'll be answering your questions on XYZ. Tweet your question on this specific hashtag. And then at the designated time, you just run through the questions on the hashtag and answer them. And if you have a chief executive who's happy to participate in that, it's a great way to show behind the scenes of your organization. Or if you have a celebrity ambassador, it's maybe a good way to draw attention to some of the work you're doing at the moment. And finally, look for conversation. This is something I'd love to see more of on Twitter. And if we think about where I started, that we see about 500 million tweets on Twitter every single day, more often than not, if there's something you want to say, someone else has already said it and they've said it really well. And so look for those tweets that are totally in line with the messages that you want to put out and could be really authentic or funny or engaging ways of sharing those messages. There's an example on screen there that I saw today from someone called Dawn. In amongst all the stresses and challenges that has been life the last few months, it was wonderful to take an hour this evening to listen to David Tennant and Gregory Doran talk all things Shakespeare. What a wonderful form of escapism at the RSC, hashtag talking Shakespeare. And the RSC have replied saying, thanks for coming, so glad it helped a bit. And I think that's brilliant for two reasons. First of all, I'm sure it will have meant something really positive to Dawn to have a direct reply from the RSC acknowledging that tweet, and it will have strengthened her relationship with that organization. Second of all, RSC tweeting that reply, their followers may have seen that and may have seen Dawn's message. And it's a great way for them to showcase the power of the work that they have organized at this time. So the opportunity with Twitter, I think, is not just to talk at your audience, which lots of people and organizations do well on Twitter already, but to talk with your audience, to engage with them closely and make sure you're translating that social media relationship into something powerful offline as well as online. Before I hand over to Hayden, I'm just gonna flag on screen some of the accounts that you might want to follow. The middle one, Twitter Marketing UK, is great for getting inspiration. It often features case studies of how organizations have used Twitter in an interesting way. Twitter support has updates on things like product changes or any support issues going on. And Twitter Media as well will often feature really interesting uses of the service. And I just wanted to showcase our campaigning handbook, our NGO handbook. So if you Google campaigningontwitter.pdf, you'll find it. I'll also share it with Hayden. So if you can't, you can contact him. But it's essentially a really comprehensive handbook of all the different ways that you can use Twitter. And it goes into answering some of the questions that you may have. So if you're building a Twitter strategy for the first time, that's a really excellent resource to go to. And finally, the Help Center, help.twitter.com. I'm a big skeptic always of any kind of computer help website, but this is honestly a really good one. And if there's a question about using Twitter that you want to get an answer to, just go here, type it in, and it's There's so much information on here that often it can really help just give you the information you need in that moment to resolve any issues you're having. So that's everything from me for now. I'll stop sharing my screen and hand back over to Hayden.
Thank you, that was brilliant. Some really insightful information there. So I'm hopefully gonna try and build on some of the points shared there. Share my screen. I'm gonna try and build on some of those points and really show you how you can join conversations and some of the features that Twitter allows you to use that will actually build on that, okay? So during my presentation and my training, I wanna try and make it as engaging as possible. I do believe social media is a two-way conversation. It's a two-way dialogue as to how you get the best out of it. So there will be segments where it'll be your turn. So you'll get the opportunity to take part in the and learn and use some of the skills that we've showcased or that I showcased during this training session, okay? So whenever you see this big mobile phone on your screen that says your turn, that's your cue to get involved. Nothing you do will turn up on your screen or it won't affect anything on your profile. So don't worry about that if you're using an organization account, and you can do it from your desktop or your mobile. Okay. So platform features and how to use them. So the features we're gonna concentrate on today is how to optimize your profile, we're gonna look at threads, and then we're gonna look at live streaming, okay? So when I say optimize your profile, we're gonna look at this specific area here. This is like this prime real estate for when people come and visit your page. We're gonna look at threads and how people use threads and how to try and get the best out of them. And then we're gonna look at live streaming. So optimizing your profile. As you can see, you've only got about 160 characters that you can use for your description. So try and make that catchy and try and make it something that's really engaging and make somebody actually want to follow you and get to know what you're doing, okay? The primary reason for that is because, again, is that it tells people what they're coming for, what they're following you about, okay? So make sure that there's the information there is clear and catchy, and remember, you've got to try and make it as concise as possible because it's only 160 characters. You can add your website. So if you want to drive traffic to your website as part of your strategy, make sure your website details are logged in. And then lastly, use keywords. The beauty about Twitter as well, and we'll talk about this later when we talk about their search function, is that their search function is probably one of the most powerful of all of the social media platforms, in my opinion. And therefore, by making sure you're using the correct keywords or terms or phrases that relate to your organization, the likelihood is that you'll come up when being searched. So profile features. So when you look at this, when you go to Twitter, this is the main profile. You'll have these different options. You'll have profile, you'll have lists, you'll have topics, bookmarks, moments, and then Twitter ads if you're using them. Mm-hmm. So lists and topics are great for curation. So it's a great way for you to learn how to curate content and to create specific timelines that are relevant for you. So with lists, you can create timelines. With topics, you can follow relevant themes or topics that are relevant to your organization. So if you was on my Instagram webinar, then you may remember I talked about following hashtags. Well, this is quite similar with topics. You can follow a certain topic that is relevant to your organization. Bookmarks is something that I think is probably maybe not quite understood. And what with bookmarks, it's pretty much, you have two different ways you can like a comment on Twitter. So you can like a tweet, and that will then be shared to your profile and shared to your feed, so people, whoever's following you, will see that you've liked this specific tweet. Or you can bookmark it, which means it's then saved privately just for you. So it's a great way of finding content if something you want to go back to at a later date that you don't want to share with your audience, and that you can just view it at your own time. And then moments is another great piece. What moments does is it allows you to curate a specific moment in time that's relevant to your audience. So it might be, so for example, recently DCN had our first anniversary, and we did quite a lot of content on Twitter. So we've got a moment that reflects that. Mm-hmm. So looking at lists, as you can see, like I said before, they're really easy to create, and they're a great way of really tailoring your feed so that you can find the people or the organizations that you're trying to follow and trying to engage with in a specific list. Now, as on the DCM page, we've got a whole host of different lists that basically allows me to be able to see different content and different narratives from different organizations as and when I want, instead of having to follow them and trying to find out who's saying what and when. So it's great to curate relevant timelines. One of the beauties of it is you don't have to follow them. You don't have to follow the organizations to have a list. You can literally just have this list. You can add them or take people off and people can follow the list, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a great way for you to make sure you're curating your timelines and you're curating your feeds as you want them to be. And then it's easy to stay informed. So a really easy way for you to, because you've curated that timeline, to actually understand what's happening within the relevant feeds that you're trying to follow. Mm-hmm. So topics. Topics is a great way to join relevant conversations. So again, as you can see here, we follow museums and institutions. So what will happen is Twitter will basically, the most relevant and the most topical conversation within that theme will be shared in our timeline. So it won't be from any specific person. It will just be, according to Twitter's algorithm, what's a relevant piece of conversation, which is buzzing or trending accordingly, okay? And like I said, it tends to be the most interesting story. So the good thing about this is it allows you to then engage with these conversations and actually show your audience that you have authority in this space and that you're ahead of the curve, or you're at least in tune of what's happening within your subject matters. Mm-hmm. And then it's a good way to boost organic awareness. Now, organizational awareness. And why I say that is because, again, because it's different organizations and different people who are using these topics, you're in talking with different people and joining conversations that might not necessarily be within your usual circle or your usual bubble. One feature that I think is probably not used very much on Twitter is the actual QR code. I say Instagram because Instagram did recently just add QR codes like 2 days ago. So you now have QR codes, and what they allows you to do is very easily allows you to get people to follow your account by scanning the QR code. Okay, so it's an easy way to increase followers. They're really simple to use. All you literally do is just get your camera up to the QR card and it will scan it and take you through to your account. And it can be used on other promo assets. So you can use it on flyers, you can put it on your website, you can put them in loads of different locations to actually help try and increase the people who are following you, okay, or engaging with your page. Then we'll look at threads. So here's a thread I made earlier. So it's a really easy way to do this. With threads, you can create a story. So when you're using a thread, always try and have a purpose. Don't just be typing randomly or be throwing out content that has no relevance. Try and create a story and create a purpose and have a clear direction of what you're trying to say. Mm-hmm. Try and keep it to one idea per point, per tweet. So don't have multiple tweets spilling off into each other. Try and make each tweet be able to live on its own. Still telling the story or the point that you're trying to get across, but they can live on, each tweet can live on its own. And then consider your audience. How do your audience like to see content? The good thing about tweets, it doesn't have to just be copy. You can add about thread. It doesn't have to just be copy. You can put images on there, photos on there, polls on there, GIFs on there, videos, etc. So think about how your audience likes to receive content and then use threads accordingly. Now, what you may have noticed nowadays, especially because threads often tend to go viral, and Twitter is probably one of the easiest platforms to go viral naturally on. But what then happens is there's loads of different replies and loads of different people who are talking on that particular thread, and it becomes hard to actually see what the original person wrote. So if you go to, at thread reader app, and then type unroll, as you can see here, what it will make it do is make it easier to follow that thread, because thread reader app will literally go through the timeline and find all of the original tweets that made up that thread. Okay. Which again makes it a lot easier and makes it a lot more accessible to everybody. So what that would look like is here, I've added it, as you can see, and it's got, and this is how it comes back. It replies back to me with whatever the thread was. You can click on the link, and then as you can see, it almost comes up like a bit of a blog post. So it goes, takes you to another link where it has all of the individual tweets that you've spoken about. And that, again, that's another great way for you to create a bit of content. If you've done this thread and the thread's done really well and it's got a lot of traction, you could then potentially change that thread into a blog post. So you've now got another piece of content that you can add to your website and that you can also amplify the messaging about what you're doing. Okay, so it's a great way of just really understanding how your audience are engaging with you and creating content that's actually relevant and meaningful to them. Now, live streaming. This is something that I think is really, really underused on Twitter. I think the main reason for that is because people don't understand that it's very easy to do, and it's not something that is naturally on the platform. So to begin with, you have to sign up via Periscope, But as soon, literally, when you go to Periscope, it asks you for your Twitter details, you log in and it's there straight away. You'll get this option to go live. So it's a really great, powerful way to talk to your audience and to engage with an audience that in a way that's probably not used very much in the arts and culture sector. Mm-hmm. So it's your turn, it's the first time, your time to have a go at it. So what kind of social media person would I be without trying to encourage new followers to my own page? So here is a great chance for you to test out the QR code. It is really easy. Just literally go to your camera, hold it up to the screen, and it should give you a little sign that says, go to the Twitter page. Give that a try. Give us a follow if you're not following us already. Thank you. I'll give you a couple of seconds to give that a try. Now, the beauty of this, again, is that these QR codes can be added anywhere. They can be anywhere that people have access to you. So your websites, other social media platforms, flyers, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. So talking about building audiences, that would be my next subject matter. So as Katie touched on, there's lots of tweets sent out. It's actually quite scary. If we're getting almost 6,000 tweets a second, which is insane when you really think about how much the number of that and the amount of people who are coming across this content. So, and you're just trying to get just a little bit of those eyeballs, a little bit of that that attention. So how do you build an audience? We're going to look at consistency and post frequency, and then we're going to look at joining conversations, which is another thing that Katie really gave some great points on, and it's a vital part of not just Twitter but social media in general. Social media should be a two-way conversation. You shouldn't be just a bit like this where I'm just talking directly at you. There should be that kind of engagement and that social call for action. So we're going to look at scheduling tools, business as usual content and asset / copy banks, repurposing content. We'll look at monitoring content reach, and then we'll monitoring your insights as well, okay? So on Twitter have recently rolled out across the globe their scheduling platform, probably in the last, I think during COVID, I believe, I could be wrong. But now everybody can schedule on Twitter. So basically, this little symbol here allows you to put your tweet in, whatever it may be, with your videos, your images, your posts, what have you. And when you click on this link here, give me a sec, it will go to this page. So what it will look like, it'll go to this page here, and it will give you the opportunity to choose the date, the time zone, and schedule the tweet. Once you schedule the tweet, you'll literally go back to the homepage, and you can press schedule, and the tweet will disappear into the atmosphere, into the ether, as they say. That's not quite true, but I'll show you where it goes next. And again, this is unfortunately currently only something that you can do online, but I'm sure we can ask Katie if they're thinking about making this, you can do it on phone at some stage on the mobile. But yes, it's currently something you can only do online. So when you schedule a tweet, this is how you go and find out where it's disappeared to. So if you go to more, and then you'll get this page here, this little display here, and then you go to Media Studio, okay? When you go to Media Studio, you'll go to schedule tweets, and that's where your tweet will, this is where your tweet will end up, okay? So we're now gonna look at consistency and post frequency. So planning content scheduling. The general consensus is 6 tweets a day is generally what it's seen as to be. If you're trying to have some sort of at least consistency on the platform, then you should consider having at least 6 tweets a day. Like we mentioned before, there's 6,000 tweets a second. So if there's that much content is being shared, then you need to try and have a presence with your audience in some way. But I can't stress this enough. Use your objectives to inform how often you post. Your objectives will help you decide what makes sense to you as an organization. So for example, if your objectives are quite small, maybe 6 tweets a day are not necessary. So really think about your personal resources, your organization's resource, and what you're trying to achieve, because that will really determine realistically how often you should be posting, okay? So business as usual content. Business as usual content for me is content that you have to talk about. So it's evergreen content or information about your organization, okay? It's something that is really easy to do, and it will help give you that consistency. Mm-hmm. So you do that by creating an asset and copy bank. You'll have evergreen content or organization information, if you just talked about. And it's a great way to repurpose and reshare, retweet content. So that's another great thing about Twitter as well, is that it allows you to retweet content. So content, if you had a piece of content that's done really well, then maybe you might want to reshare it. Or maybe you've had a piece of content that's been shared by a larger account, so you've had really high impressions, but maybe your organic reach isn't that much. That basically means, when I say reach, that means that your actual audience haven't, that much of your audience haven't actually come across this tweet. So that might be another reason for you to reshare that or retweet that content, okay? And I'll show you how to do that a little bit later. Our content reach, there we go. So here's a great example of the DCN doing the same thing. So what we basically did, we posted this video here with my lovely colleague Saeed, who is managing our questions for me here. And we posted this video, and as you can see, the very first time we posted it, we got 780 impressions and 233 media views. It was about one of the events that we do with Google. We posted the same video 11 days later, I believe. Again, similar content, but this time we're talking about the fact that the actual event was this day. It was live. Today's the day. Here's the event. And it got 8,000 impressions in the second time and 858 media views. So across the two posts, you can see it's the same video, slightly tweaked copy, but more people have seen it. We've got more media views and we've got more engagements. And if you combine the numbers together, then that's even better. But it's the same video. So what this is telling you, that you can always try and think about content that's relevant that you can repurpose and reuse. I like to use the example of news outlets. If you look at Sky News or look at any other, or any newspaper, for example, they're constantly posting the same information throughout the day. So throughout the day, you'll see the same news story article, maybe said in a different way, but you'll see it posted throughout the day because they understand that people view Twitter at different time frames and different timelines, okay? So one good thing about the Media Studio, which we didn't really touch on it very much when I first showed you to it, is that the Media Studio, for all intents and purposes, is an asset bank. You can use it as an asset bank. And what it basically does is, anytime you tweet a media, so a media could be a voice note, an audio, something audio, an image, a video, a GIF, it will be saved in the Media Studio. And then what you can then do is go back to the studio and literally post the content, like repurpose the content again and reshare it accordingly, okay? So it's a really good place for you to share content and maybe even use as a way for your other people in your organization to come in and actually know content that's been approved and that's ready to use. You can also upload content directly to it so that you're not tweeting it out. So again, it's a good place to basically have an asset bank. Now, this is the copy bank that we use for the DCN. And I'll send you a copy of this in our notes when we send it out. But basically what we do with the copy bank is literally, it's just different variations of the same theme written up. So as you can see here, this is for the network. We've got, not sure what the digital culture network is all about. And let me tell you about it here. Then there's another tweet. The digital culture network's tech champions are digital specialists on hand to provide support and training for the arts and culture sector. So it's literally just the same kind of information, just 10 different ways. And it allows me to then say, okay, we can schedule this content as and when we want. So we've got a consistency across our pages. And then it can be any of, about anything you want to be. So we've got our newsletters, it could be about social media channels, it could be about what time your shows are open, it could be previous events, it could be old content, it could be whatever you want to be your business usual content. But it's this great way for you to say, okay, I've got this done, I can take it, schedule it, and you're good to go. So again, as Katie touched on, joining conversations is a really important part of Twitter, okay? And using lists and using topics is a great way to do that. Helps you contribute to relevant conversations, helps you reshare trending topics, and it helps to show subject authority, okay? So really think about how you can engage with lists or create your own lists so that you're following timelines that are relevant to you and that will keep you ahead of the curve and will help you show authority to your to your audience. Mm-hmm. Now, one of my favorite tools on Twitter, which is, again, something that I think is really underused, is their search function. Their search function is incredibly powerful, okay? And one of the good things about it is you can save searches so you can go back to it and look what you want. Remember when we spoke earlier about optimizing your profile? Just by having the word museum, you can see the different museum titles that come with museum in it. So again, it's a really powerful way to find content, to find relevant conversations, to find influencers, to find other organizations or people who may be in your space. Mm-hmm. So looking at how it works. So as you can see, when you go to search or search museums, it will give you from anyone. So from anyone, that basically means anybody who has used the term museum. It'd be from people you follow. So if you're looking for your audience specifically to see what they've said about museums, you can be from anywhere. It can be near you. Near you is another great way of using search. Because let's say, for example, there's somebody who's looking for events near you. That was the key phrase that you use, you're looking for, you can engage that conversation. You can join that conversation and maybe potentially draw somebody to your event and let them know that your event is happening in their vicinity. But for me, the real powerful part is the advanced search. That's where things really get fun, if you're a geek like me anyway. So when you look at this, they've got a whole variety of different ways that you can search Twitter. So you can use all of these words. So that would be what and how it's happening, for example. You can exclude words. So you don't want anything that contains cats and dogs. You can change the language. There's so many different things you can do. You can have tweets only sent from Arts Council UK, for example, if that's what you want to look for. And that mentioned the Digital Culture Network. There's such a wide variety of ways that you can really just engage and really find the relevant information for you. So you can turn off replies, you can turn off links. Turning off links is a good way as well. So for example, if you're trying to join conversations and you don't want tweets with links in it, the reason you might do that because that's more likely to be a conversational piece and not a promotional piece. So if it hasn't got links in it, then you can engage with that conversation and you can hopefully build a narrative around that, similar to what we were talking about earlier. Mm-hmm. Then you can add dates, et cetera, et cetera. So here's an example that I done. So I did Twitter tips as the exact phrase. And I wanted to have minimum of 30 replies. And for me doing that, as you can see, now this was an older post, but what it was, it showed me a relevant piece of content that I could share with my audience if I was looking for anything on Twitter tips. And just from doing that, I've now got an extra piece of content that I can reshare and that is providing education or providing relevancy to my audience, just from a quick search on using their filters. So it's a really powerful tool and really something that I would really recommend that you start to look into and start to save your own searches so that you can actually start joining the relevant conversations and sharing relevant content to your audience. So it's your turn again. So on this one, now you don't have to do this on your phone. You can do this on your desktop or your phone. This is one, we've created a whole host of different lists that might be relevant to arts and culture organizations, from arts and culture blogs to different NPO, all of the NPOs who are in the different disciplines. So we've got combined arts, dance NPOs, all of the Arts Council funded organizations. So what we simply do is we go to the main profile, we go to our profile, you click on these three dots. Once you click on those three dots, you click on view lists. Very, very simple. And it's again, this, by you following these lists, what it allows you to do is make sure you're curating your timelines that are relevant to you. Mm-hmm. Once you click on the list, it will give you all of the options you have there. So I've clicked on combined arts, for example, and you simply follow it. And this is basically made up, the combined arts is literally made up of all of the different combined arts NPOs that the comms team know of that are Arts Council funded. It's as simple as that. And just from doing that, you now know if you're combined arts NPO, then you now know this is what the rest of the sector is doing or a segment of the sector within that space. Okay, so something really easy for you to do. And again, it helps you to start thinking about how you can join conversations relevant to you and your audience. Mm-hmm. If you're doing this on mobile, so it's exactly the same process, but you go to these. So in the top corner, you'll have the three little dots in the top, and it's exactly the same process. You'll get this up, press follow. It's exactly the same, okay? So next, how do we measure results? This is the key one. So we've started to look at now how to optimize your page. We know how to start to join conversation. We've looked at how to get more consistency. How do we now see if all these steps we're taking are actually working? How do we measure the results of this? For me, this is very simple. Have a clear objective and benchmarking. Now, benchmarking can be looked at as quite a basic way of judging social media, but I believe at the level and the space that a lot of arts and culture organizations are in, benchmarking is a perfect way to begin to get you on that journey of understanding how analytics work and understanding how your data, your insights work. So what's an objective? For me, I think it's best me to explain how you even decipher what an objective is and how you decide how that works for your organization. So I'll use the DCN as an example, and I'll give an example metric and objective for us. So our vision is to increase the digital footprint of the arts and culture sector. Our goal is to educate the sector in digital marketing best practice. Our objective is to increase webinar signups and brand awareness by X amount on Twitter. So if I'll stop here for a second. If you can see, all three of these align. So to increase the digital footprint in arts and culture sector, that's our vision. That's what we aspire to do. Our goal is to educate the sector. And we're educating the sector by creating webinars and by increasing our brand awareness so that more people know that we're about, so that we can actually help more organizations, help more of the arts and culture sector. So they all kind of, they all play into each other. Then the KPIs, we'll use Twitter analytics and CTR, which is click-through rates and impressions, or link clicks, as it's called on Twitter. And then we'll have metrics and measurements like Twitter engagement types, which again, I'll break down for you a little bit later. So with your clear objectives, make sure you know what you're trying to achieve, okay? How does it relate to your wider digital objectives? So how does what you're trying to achieve play out, not just on social media, on Twitter, but play out with the rest of the things you're trying to achieve online? Use your objectives to inform how you post. As I said earlier, your objectives will define how many times you've got to post, what kind of content you want to post, how you engage with your audience. Your objectives should help push that narrative. So our example is objectives are brand awareness and driving traffic to our webinars. So here's an example before I do that, I'll show you how you even get to insight page, actually, that makes more sense. So how you get to the actual analytics page is very simple. You can go to the Media Studio, as we showed you before, and go to analytics up here. Or you can go to your profile page and literally just go to analytics and it will take you to the Twitter analytics page. That page basically looks like this in a nutshell. It will show you how many tweet your impressions for that over the 7-day period is what we've got active here. It will show you how many tweets you sent that generated the amount of impressions. So this might be 2,000 impressions and that was sent over 3 tweets, for example. You can change the how many days you go back past. And then it also gives you how it also explains down here what your actual engagement rate is and how you work that out. So engagement rate is basically your impressions divided by engagements. Okay, so as you can see downstairs, so the engagement rate was 3.4% for this specific tweet. And then in reaches is not something they don't actually show on Twitter, but it's very easy to work out. So it's just reach, it's just impressions divided by total followers. And again, as I touched on earlier, if you've got a tweet that's done well organically and it's got a lot of impressions, but maybe not a lot of your audience have seen it, understanding the reach will help you know if you should retweet that or reshare that piece of content. Okay, so that's a really easy way of doing it. Further down the page, you'll get more engagement. So you'll get your engagement rate, what your links look like, how many people have retweeted and commented, et cetera, et cetera. And then you can actually choose the amount of time you want to go back. So you can look at monthly, you can look at the last 28 days, et cetera, et cetera. Now, if you're an organization who haven't tweeted a lot, then you can go quite far back into it. You can go back up to 3,200 tweets, I believe. So you can go, if your organization haven't tweeted that many times across the split time period, you'll be able to benchmark quite easily because you'll be able to look back quite far back and say, okay, we're going to benchmark for the year, for the 6 months, for the quarter, et cetera, et cetera. That's a really good way of you starting that process, okay? What I would say when you're benchmarking, try to calculate the mean average. So let's say you're doing the quarter, calculate the mean average for the quarter. And then you can say, okay, we make 77,000 on average. We want to, now that we know how to create content consistently, now that we know how to engage audiences, we want to increase that by 10, 20, 30, 40%. Depending on what your resources are like and how much time you have to put on social media, okay? And then again, align the KPIs to objectives and resource levels, similar to what we discussed. So how do you measure the relevant KPIs? Now there's so many different KPIs to look at, but again, you need to think about what your objectives are, okay? So thinking about what our objectives were brand awareness and driving people to our webinars, okay? So I'm gonna leave this on the screen for a couple of seconds. I want you to think about looking at all of these different metrics, and these are the different engagements metrics that Twitter allows. I want you to have a think about, based on what we just said about brand awareness being one of our key objectives and driving people to our webinars as our two key objectives, as this example, what are the metrics here do you think would be relevant? leave your comments in the site to see. I can't actually see them. Okay. So for me, impressions, because we want to be, brand awareness is something that we're trying to achieve. So if we don't have, if the impressions are low, then obviously people aren't knowing about us or seeing our content or understanding what we're doing. Details expanded. This was an interesting one for me, because what this means for me is that means that people actually didn't just scroll, didn't just see this tweet in their profile. They actually stopped and looked at it, and they expanded the tweet in their page. So they took in the information, they watched the video, they looked at the whatever it may be. So that was an interesting one for me, because that then says to me how many people, I can then look at how many people actually converted to go through. And then finally, link clicks. Because again, we're trying to drive people towards our webinar. So if people have clicked the link, that means they're actually obviously engaged and they're going through to our webinar. So here's a wonderful picture of my colleague, Nick, being very passionate about CRM here. And this is that was the post that we just looked at insights for. And what you can see from here, what we can learn is that there's a video here, there's a couple hashtags, it's got the link, we've explained what's happening in the tweets. So now we're gonna try and compare this with another tweet, which is quite similar, but again, just give you an idea of how you would benchmark. Now, I have to stress this is a very, very top level and basic way of looking at this. And this is, you ideally would do it across more with more information, across more tweets and get a better understanding of how your audience is engaging. However, in this way, just as a highlight, this is how I'm gonna show it to you. So this is a similar tweet. Again, only difference is this time you didn't have a video, but we have the card straight through to Eventbrite page to book the event. Now, if you look at this one, the impressions were really low. So the impressions were 376. There's no video, so therefore there's no need to expand the card. The likes were lower, the detail, the profile clicks were lower. But our link clicks were pretty much the same. So the link clicks were 6 on the previous one and 5 on this one. So looking at that, information-wise, I could look at this and say, okay, objectively, when we put videos out, they perform better. So from an impressions point of view, then we need to maybe create more video content. You could say that people engage better with it because they've got more retweets from it. You could say that more people like this content when it was seen as a video as well, because maybe it's more informative over than us just doing the card. So these are the kind of bits of information you can start to look at and start to figure out what works best for your audience and what's going to deliver on your objectives, okay? So link clicks, mean average. So let's say I was trying to get the mean average for link clicks. For us, so in these two tweets, the mean average would be 6, and let's say we want 6 per month. This is now going to help us inform how often we need to post, because we can say the mean average, we're getting 6. So if we need to get 30 per month, we need to post 5 times throughout the month about this specific thing. So this is what I mean when I go back to saying, let your objectives inform how often you're going to post and let you know what kind of content you need to put out and when to put it out. And then review that content and data and consistently be looking at what's performing the best. Did the video perform better? Did it perform better when we got a GIF? Did it perform better as a thread? Review the content and really think about how your content's going out to really understand what's the best way that your audience likes to see likes to receive content from you. So use your analytics to inform you on what's working, when's the best time to post. Understand your current audience. These are the key things that you can use for Twitter's analytics for. Mm-hmm. In regards to benchmarking, you can look at your past results. So as we just showed you, you can go back up to 3,200 tweets. So that might be 3 months, 6 months, a year, depending on how many tweets you posted. It helps you create realistic KPIs. So you can because you're benchmarking, you can create your KPIs based on what you know you've achieved doing working a certain way and now how you're gonna work going forward, okay? And then think about your internal process. How is your organization set up? How much money do you have to put into social media? How much time do you have to put into social media? If you've only got one person who works 5 hours a week on social media, maybe having really high KPIs isn't realistic for you. So really keep your internal process in mind. Really think about how that works for you as an organization. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen now, and we're going to have me and Katie are going to have a little conversation about new features and insights from the lockdown and things that are happening on Twitter currently. Hello.
Hiya.
How are you? So yes, I've run through quite a lot there. Hopefully everybody's got some information. I mean, yeah, how's Twitter been during COVID? What has there been any big observations that they've noticed with the way people tweet going forward now? Or
one of the accounts that I mentioned in my slide, Twitter Marketing UK, shared some research that we had done over the past few months, looking at how the conversation in the UK had changed during COVID. And there's a number of things that stood out. So definitely worth taking a look at the full publication, but I thought I'd just draw on three. The first is just the massive amount of creativity and imagination that we've seen. I think for some it's born out of necessity. For others, it's a desire to entertain at a time when we're so restricted in what we can do. But you know, we've seen about 54% of 18 to 24 year olds finding a new way to make money during lockdown, which I think speaks to that rise in that imagination that's taken place. A couple of others to call out, that the first is the mental health conversation, which has been described as hashtag the other epidemic. And on the one hand, the growth of that conversation is really worrying because it shows what a major issue it is for us all as we've suffered COVID-19 and the lockdown. But on the other hand, there are some positives. So 33% of people who have tweeted about mental health hadn't done so before. So maybe that also shows people are being more open about the impacts that some of the circumstances we're in are having on their mental health. And some of those conversations are really positive. And I suppose that the third trend, just to point out, which really has been nice to see in the research, is the growth in befriending and using Twitter in supportive ways. So 420% increase in daily mentions about helping our neighbours, and using Twitter not only to organise and facilitate that important work and volunteering that's been done over the past few months, but also to show support virtually. And even things like Netflix watch parties, which is a term that's been created in the past few months, speaks to that use of the internet and social media and Twitter to feel less alone at a time when we've been so isolated.
Yeah, that's brilliant. That's brilliant. And I think that's something that a lot of cultural organisations have really picked up on. There's been some brilliant examples of that, from home artifact bingo, where people literally been playing bingo, and then different pieces will come out and people can tweet what they want to know about the information. So there's been some really great examples of that online. And is there anything new coming from Twitter that we should be looking out for, or any new product features? I know there was a voice note segment for a couple of days there. And
yeah, so there's the voice notes for sure, which is basically just the ability to tweet out a voice note, and you can record it as you create a tweet. The other one I wanted to mention was conversation controls, and that is something we made available to everyone last week. And it gives you the opportunity to choose who can reply to your tweets. So it could be people you follow, it could be people you specifically call out, it could be no one at all, or it could be everyone, which is the default setting on Twitter. There's two reasons why I think it's a really good change. First of all, safety, that lots of people who've been abused in the past, perhaps on Twitter, and are hesitant to tweet out because they don't want to deal with the replies they're going to get, it hopefully gives them a sense of confidence in sharing their view because they know they can manage who can respond to that tweet. And second, I think there's a real opportunity to create more interesting conversations, in that if you're going to tweet something out and you call out specifically who you want to reply to that tweet, you could actually get some really interesting, compelling content from that. And rather at the moment where most tweets just do have that default everyone to reply, it can mean that the conversation isn't necessarily quite as structured or going in the direction you want it to. So it just gives you a bit more of an opportunity to manage that discussion that you want to have in your tweets.
So you can really tailor your conversations, which would be really interesting.
That's yeah. Brilliant.
Well, thank you. We've got some questions. So I'm going to try and read through some of them. We've got about probably 8 minutes or so. So I'm going to try and answer some. So here's a question for both of us. What's the best type of asset to use on Twitter? Links, photos, videos, etc. I can go, or you? Yeah, I can go for that one. I tend to find videos. I think there's a lot of data that suggests that videos work the best, and that it's a good way to get in front of people. What I would suggest, though, is if you, especially from an accessibility point of view and from a usability case standpoint, if you can put captions on it, that would work very well.
I would agree with that. We basically see a spectrum, as you'd expect, that the richer the media, the more likely it is to be engaged with. And on video, really, it's three things to remember. First, be short. Even kind of a 15-second video, which is already pretty short, in those first 7 seconds, you want to be getting across the key messages, and the first 2 seconds really conveying, either in a title or just in what's being said, the real point of the video, because so many people will just scroll through and you want to have that impact quickly. Second, be accessible, as Hayden said. Use captions, give lots of context in the tweet. Most people are going to be looking at it on their commute or watching telly, and they won't have the sound on. And third, be timely. Like, you'll often see some videos do incredibly well, and that's because they have been shared really quickly at a point or a moment where loads of people are going to be sharing video. But if you get there first, it's a massive opportunity for yours to be the voice that represents that major cultural moment or whatever it may be.
There's actually, if you go to Media Studio and go to Insights, you can actually see the best time of day to post your videos as well. So that's another good little thing for you to do if you're using videos. When repurposing content, are you deleting the previous version? Would that also deleted the recorded impressions engagement received from it? So personally, when I repurpose content and reshare on Twitter, no, I'm not. I find Twitter, especially when it comes to repurposing and resharing content, is probably the best platform to do it because of the turnaround of content and the turnaround of how many tweets are being shared at one stage. So I'm definitely not deleting any of the content. If you're someone who's not posting that frequently, there could be maybe an argument for that. But also, I would also go back to saying that if anybody's watching your timeline that intensely, you've got a real good follower there. So you should be okay to be resharing the content. Any books, additional resources on Twitter, social media strategy? Is there any good Twitter books? I don't know.
The main one would be Campaigning on Twitter. So search campaigningontwitter.pdf. And it's really detailed. And typically, it's a great starting point. And it's also something to just have in your back pocket. If there's a question you've got, invariably, that will have the answer.
You said you're going to send that to me, so I can send that out. Yep. So I'll send that to you. I'll send that through to you guys. When we send through our resources. Why would a QA code work be better than a link to follow? It's not necessarily that it's better, it's more about ease of use and the fact that you can share it anywhere. So you can share it offline. So for example, if I share it on a flyer or I put it on a post, or as I used it in this presentation, you can literally just use your photo to scan it, use your phone to scan it, camera phone to scan it, and it will go straight through to that page. Instead of having that the whole, oh, can you follow me and find my hashtag and trying to search it, you can just literally scan the QR code and it brings up straight away. I'm sure you get this all the time, so I'm going to ask it and see what happens. Will blue tick applications come back soon, and how does someone apply, please? the most famous
for those on the call that don't know, we have a verification program at Twitter, which historically people could apply to have that blue tick, and it would basically verify that you are who you say you are. So if I had a blue tick, which I don't, it would be the knowledge that I am Katie Minchell, and Twitter have checked that. We put it on hold because we saw that it had generated confusion, because some people thought it was an endorsement from Twitter. So if someone had a blue tick, what did that mean? Did that mean you should trust everything they're saying? So that program publicly has been under review, but in the meantime, we're basically continuing to maintain it. And there are a very small number of accounts that will still qualify for verification at this time. So a really classic example is the general election last year, MPs who lost their seat, who have been verified, the new MP taking their place would be eligible for verification. So it's really limited at the moment who is eligible. What I would say is, if you think that you are an organization that would really benefit from a blue tick, or if you did used to have a blue tick but you've lost it because you've changed your account username, then you're welcome to get in touch with Hayden, who can contact me and we can go from there.
But only if you had a blue tick to begin with, not this. just to confirm. Again, this is something I see asked quite often, but I'm pretty sure Twitter, they've made it quite clear they're not going to do this. Is there potential to feature to edit tweets once they've been posted? And I think the reason I've seen online most of the time is that it then doesn't allow, if somebody retweeted it or somebody else has shared it, then and you've changed the tweet, then it's obviously, it's a different conversation that piece is being had. I believe that's the general consensus for why that happens there.
Yeah, that's right.
And I think that is about it. I just want to say thank you for everybody for coming. Just to let you know that we have a lot more webinars coming up. We also have a new Google Arts and Culture webinar series that is, I believe, is launching next week, I believe. So you can sign up for those as well. And I just always like to end on a final thought, because personally, I think we should end, should never end on Q&As. So my final thought is as follows. Twitter is not just about consuming content, but sharing it, passing it on and adding to it, from the amazing Arena Huffington. Okay. So literally, I hope everybody had a great day and everybody's taken something from this. I will share the resources within the week or so. This webinar will also be available online for anybody to view it and to rewatch it. And if you do want to get in contact with the Digital Culture Network, please do get in touch. If you're arts, council funded organization, or it you are eligible to be funded by the Arts Council, then you can reach out for one-to-one support. We also have a website which is available, which has loads of free resources, which is open to everybody. And obviously give us a follow on Twitter, where we share information, do live Q&As, and I will start doing live streams via Periscope very soon. It's been up. Hope everybody's good, and I will see you soon.
Bye
bye.